Howdy folks, and welcome back to Next Level Games Eternal Masters Weekend. We're here with, obviously, Next Level Games. We're here with a bonus helping of Vintage. We had a 650-player Vintage event yesterday, and now, just a little casual thing, we've got a Melbourne Vintage League going on at the moment. A couple of our players, since we've got all the streaming gear set up, are happy to play their game out here on the stream. You're going to have myself and Jimbo Dowling is just turning up now to commentate, a little friendly banter perhaps.
On time as always.
It's a little bit more casual. We just finished the, obviously, beyond the 50 player vintage event we had yesterday, we had another 67 player legacy event. This is all sanctioned, so 54 vintage yesterday was amazing.
Oh yeah.
Yep. How did you go in the end?
Not well.
Not well?
No.
I didn't go well either. I decided that there would be a lot more Mentor than there was, packed accordingly, and I was punished.
I lost two matches to me being really bad at Magic mm-hmm. the Gathering. One match to my opponent being really good at Magic the Gathering.
Okay, we do have to apologize, guys, because this is a league, it is up to 60 proxies, or up to, actually, it's unlimited. Battle of Wits, you can play proxied if you want. Both players have taken a mulligan, but there are a few proxies in each player's deck. Queries we can ask, but we're just going to guess what it is. I know Talarian Academy is currently being proxied in both players' decks. And Lee Greaves here is on like a blue-red moon deck. Titular card right there. Graham, on the other hand, is running Bomberman. Graham actually played this deck to a second-place finish in last night's Vintage. Lee, I believe, played this to about a 32nd place in yesterday's Vintage.
Yeah, he was not the highest placed unpowered player. That one went to somewhere around 12th, I believe.
Ninth. Lachlan Ward-Smith has been playing Green-White Bears in as long as I can remember him playing Vintage.
Yeah.
And he has played the same Green-White Hate Bears list, updated a bit. And he managed to break ninth, which means in the 5 years I've been involved with Masters here at NLG, that's the closest we've ever gone to unpowered top eight.
You're going to have to help me here. Is that a Hammer Mage?
That is a Hammer Mage. Now, you can pull that up if you want, but I believe it's red and one. Red tap.
Is it discard a card? Right?
Yeah, it meltdowns or
it's
smelts.
It's a meltdown spell shaper.
Yeah, so you discard a card with X and its casting cost. No, it's X and red, tap, discard a card, destroy all artifacts with converted mana cost X or less.
Well,
so you can tap, discard a random card, and kill that Mox Sapphire. That moon coming down, not hindered as much as it could have been by the not hindering Graham as much as it could have with that island there. Now, you're going to have to help me with what that card is.
That one is Felden of the Third Path. Let me get the text for you for us in the booth. And I'll read it out for you. It costs one and a red and a red. It's a legendary creature, human, artificer. And it's a 2/3. It's got two and a red and tap. To put a token into play that's a copy of a creature in your graveyard, except it's an artifact in addition to its other types. It gains haste, sack it at the end of turn.
And Lee Greaves has just shown us Ashen Rider in his hand, so he can discard that to the Hammer Mage and bring a copy of it back into play.
This is a brew, isn't it?
This is a Lee Greaves special. No! Don't bounce!
That's right, Felden is a 2/3. Powerful enough to attack through the Trinket Mage here. We see a fancy mountain being played by Lee Greaves there.
It's a very expensive mountain. One of the most expensive mountains.
The Scalding Tarn? There's plenty more expensive mountains. There's more expensive mountain on Graham's side. Is that the tundra that Graham won yesterday?
Possibly.
Yeah.
So what do you feel about bouncing a Hammer Mage? How does that make you feel?
Look.
You bounce a Blightsteel, it's fine.
In Vintage League, you do a lot of strange things. So far, I've mana drained a Memnite in the last Vintage League.
That's quite impressive.
There was a Skull Clamp and a pair of Genesis Chambers. I feel justified in my actions.
You may feel justified, but you will be judged.
I will be ridiculed. I am very well aware of this. Oh, boom, Vendilion click, down for the blocks.
Lee Greaves just managing to not get his combo together by one turn.
Oh, this is a trick deck, is that what you're telling me?
It's a trick deck.
All those extra blood moons not doing much.
And the click gets to put the Ashen Rider on the bottom of the deck.
I'm waiting for someone to come in and say, what are they actually playing here? And we have to say Vintage.
Who are the generals here?
Well, they're both legendary creatures, but unfortunately that Tundra, if Vendilion click is his general,
we're gonna have to
can only tap for blue.
We might actually have to give Graham a penalty here for playing a Tundra in his mono blue commander deck.
There is a Scalding Tarn in the mono red list also.
Scalding Tarn's fine. It does not have any red symbols. Although there was an Ashen Rider. Alright, maybe this is not Commander.
Maybe. Maybe it is just Hell and we're watching Hell in Vintage. Maybe that's what Hell is.
Is this 93-94? No, what is a Planeswalker?
What I was saying last night in the 93-94 tournament we had, imagine how good Tarmogoyf would have been back then.
Oof.
You had Mono Artifact, Poly Artifact, Mana Source, Interrupt. Tarmogoyf could easily be a 9-10.
Doesn't even need Tribal.
Here we go. Graham just...
He's
not letting Lee have fun, is he?
He's basically got free reign here. Lee's playing the lock pieces, Graham's playing the chase. I know which side of the table I'd prefer to be on.
Definitely the side with Blood Moon and Ashen Rider in the same deck.
You are a Workshops player. You would prefer to be locking your opponent out. I just want to be chasing.
Chasing is for the weak.
Do you reckon there's a deck that can play Jace and Goblins?
Well, there used to be like a weird blue-red Goblins list, but it was mostly for Stifle.
If you find me one...
Okay, I think that's a Talarian Academy in front of a mountain, which makes it a mountain.
We'll get our guy on the scene to help us out with that.
That's all good. Yeah, Talarian
Academy.
If I say it's a Talarian Academy, it's a Talarian Academy.
Doesn't tap for much. Oh, it's a mountain. That's why it's proxied on a mountain. Because it's three times a mountain.
Because real men proxy over Arabian Nights mountains.
And then use Blood Moon to turn it back into a mountain. It's the synergy, you know? The proxies and the Blood Moons. Are you in the current Vintage League? You are.
I am in the current Vintage League. I've gone 1-1 with my Channel Mirror deck that I'm playing for... Snits and giggles.
Yeah, I'm 2-0 at the moment. I happened to catch Graham after his second place last night and caught him on a low note and got some games in there and walked away with the victory.
Bear in mind, for those watching with the Melbourne Vintage League, to ensure we get as much vintage as possible, we are playing with best of five. And so this after game one is boarding, same with games 2, 3, and 4.
Mm-hmm.
So first game is pre-board, and then we can have up to 4 additional games, all post-board.
Yeah, it's pretty sweet. It's more vintage. Workshops, you know, people are scared that Workshops and Dredge are unplayable because of this. That's not true. We've had multiple Workshops decks in the previous top 8. We had a Dredge player in the last top 8.
Our Dredge player... has made... We've got one guy who sits there and he plays Dredge and he's top 8ed, what, 2 of the last 3? And
yeah.
He's been on the bubble for all 4?
Mm.
What is this now, our 4th or our 5th round?
It's our 5th.
This is our 5th?
Yeah.
It's been a while since I remember starting it up. God, that was a long time ago.
So we see an island here from Lee Greaves. This is highly unusual. Lee Greaves is there to punish the Blue Mages, not be one himself.
Maybe that's why he's losing.
Maybe. I did play against Lee Greaves yesterday. We had some sweet games.
Yeah?
Well, that was sweet for me.
Were you Jacing too?
I was Jacing, yeah. I might have ultimated Tamiyo.
Tamiyo I can respect. Because you can lock your opponent out with Tamiyo.
Oh, yes, you can.
Let's look at your hand again.
Staff of Nin, that card scares me a lot.
Goblin Welder goes away, Ashen Rider.
Everything that I don't want to see on the other side of the table.
I don't think he's going to be casting that Ashen Rider this game.
Look, all it takes is
Lotus. Well, Lotus for white, weld it back in, Lotus for black.
Got him.
Got him. Done.
Unfortunately, he has no Lotus in this deck. It is an unpowered deck in preparation for yesterday's event.
Is it unpowered?
Yeah. As far as I know, spoilers to everyone watching at home.
Lotus Petal for white. Weld it back in. Lotus Petal for white. Weld it back in.
How many artifacts has he got to weld out? I know he's got Ensnaring Bridges in there. They were stopping my Mishra's Factories from attacking. I'll tell you what, watching the 93-94 last night was actually just like watching a bunch of Landsteel Mirrors.
Oh, at least the control decks were.
Oh, yeah. Disenchant, Swords to Plowshares, Counterspell, Mishra's Factory is my win condition.
My problem with that format is Mishra's Factory was just the best card in the format.
Yeah, look, it was pretty sweet. Ensnaring Bridge.
Two cards in hand. That's not that good.
Especially not when it doesn't resolve. So these guys here today, they're playing the first and second rounds of the Melbourne Vintage League. It is a proxied event, but the prizes are very real. The first prize at the end of the eight rounds and the top eight is this time around is a Time Vault. Second prize being a Tropical Island. And the third and fourth prize being mana drains each. There might be something for fifth through eighth as well.
Hi, avid user. We've got we actually had a fully sanctioned vintage event with 50 players yesterday. If you want to go back and look at sanctioned vintage, we do have the videos on demand should be under past broadcasts. But if we are looking at if this is just a vintage league game, just throwing it out there because we have the stream set up and we do have a couple of guys willing to play some vintage. We're just throwing this out. So this is proxied. Both of these players are well known in the vintage community. They're just playing what they want.
Yeah. All right. We're going to pop back to the booth. Get our pretty faces on camera here. You're right, Zombub. This is Jimbo. This is Josh. We're here commenting a random vintage league game. Because why not?
How many players do we have in the vintage? Is it 26 this time?
It was 26. We've had two late entries, so that brings us up to 28.
28 for just... Yeah. So the vintage league, how it's operated here in Melbourne, started off 3 years ago?
Yeah, that long ago? Something like that. 2 years ago, 3 years, something like that.
Two, 3 years ago. Basically, what we do is we get the guys who want to play some vintage. It is a lot of newer players also, guys who don't have the cards, some of them. A lot of the older guys that can't make weekends and things like that for when we do want to actually play vintage, proper tournament, what we do is we pair them all up. We give them two names every 2 weeks, and you've got to organize your own time to play. You play best of five, report your scores back, and we just run the tournament like that. And so going through the time, we eventually cut to a top eight, and that's when we're playing for some real prizes. We all get together. Those who don't have the cards pull it all together, so we've got plenty of commentary.
Mm. Yeah, it's pretty sweet. If you check out, Sneaker Show's got the videos up for the last top eight somewhere, right? They streamed our last top eight for us.
Yeah, I think they're up on YouTube, possibly. Yeah, if they're not up on YouTube, again, past broadcasts.
Mm. Although this was run on the test channel, so...
Yeah, it was run on the test channel. Unfortunately, I spent the entire day spruiking it on Twitter and Facebook, saying, guys, you got to go to this, you got to go to this. And then eventually it was just on a different channel. So all the links just went to channel not broadcasting.
So if you can't find them on YouTube, the URL for your current Twitch stream, add test to the end of that and check out the past broadcast there. You'll see the Melbourne Vintage League 4 top 8 there. We cast Vintage whenever we get the chance. The Vintage League Top 8s, any large-scale Vintage events like the the Masters event, unfortunately we don't get to do any work at GPs or anything like that.
Yes, unfortunately the GPs are all run by the TO that does all the GPs, and we can't stream there.
Yeah.
We did manage... I believe Sneak and Show did stream a GP.
Yeah, they did Melbourne GP last year. Was it last year?
Yeah, GP 14. Time GP flies. Melbourne 14. They managed to do the streaming, but there was no side events there. It was just the main event. That was the one won by the South Korean guy, I believe, that went on to do really well on the Pro Tour.
Yeah. Was it Nam Sung-wook?
Yeah, I believe so.
I don't know any pro players' names, unfortunately.
That's all right. But other than that, it's much more casual, much more relaxed. The league format allows us to do people to organise matches at their own time.
Yeah.
Judging's quite ad hoc also.
Yeah, look, I'm on call for most of the league. I'm sure if they have any issues that here, then they're going to give me a call. Graham flashing a 7 that didn't look great.
It had a sword and a pearl.
Well, that's all you need, right? Don't need a way to win, just stop your opponent winning.
Typical Jace player. I'll find my thinker eventually.
Thanks for tuning in, Jason, and everyone else in the chat.
I don't know who this Jason guy is. That's Zombub.
Yeah, that's Zombub. Very prominent elves player in the local community. I once saw him in a standard game day casting a Huntmaster of the Fells with a Master Biomancer in play. Now that is value. Lee Greaves opening with an island. Is this actually Lee Greaves? Is this
real life?
I don't even understand. And an Ensnaring Bridge with...
And a Hammer Mage in hand.
5 cards in hand. Good old Ensnaring Bridge, 5 cards, the combo.
So if Graham were to play a Lodestone Golem, give it haste, he could still attack.
Oh yes. That's what we're going to see here. Where's the Lotus? Tonight, we're just streaming this one match of the Vintage League. Today was a Legacy tournament. Yesterday was Sanctioned Vintage. We had 6 rounds. But tonight, just the one round of the Vintage League.
You got a Vintage deck on you?
Yeah, I've got a Vintage deck on me.
Well, you can run out there and play some games afterwards. Come on, you know you want to. I can give you Storm.
Storm? I'll play some Storm on stream. I will mangle that deck so bad.
Yes, I want to dissect your plays.
I am not a proficient Storm player.
And it's proper TPS. You get to play basics.
Hey, look, if the viewers want to see me playing Storm badly...
I'll probably put Gush together also. I was playing against Lee Greaves just testing for the Vintage event yesterday. It was really fun. I managed to win on from the board state of I have nothing.
Right.
You're on 15 life. You have a Goblin Welder. You have... Yeah, he had a Null Rod too.
Jeez.
And he had... for those who don't know, Lee Greaves' deck is a trick deck.
A trick deck, yes.
A trick deck is when he tries to do something tricky.
Assembling a trick.
So what he does is he gets Hammer Mage. Hammer Mage lets you discard a card, and then he uses whatever the name of that red card is to make copies of things from his graveyard.
I'm sorry, this blue card that he's just drawn, can you tell me whether or not that is in fact in the Eye of Chaos?
I believe that is an in the Eye of Chaos, however it is a proxy for either Flash or something else.
Oh, you disappoint me, Lee.
No, he was testing and did play in the Eye of Chaos yesterday the Vintage event.
It resolved against me. And Wait, was
did sadness resolve?
It was promptly disenchanted.
Oh. Did you pay 4 for that disenchant?
I did.
Sadness resolves whenever in the Eye of Chaos.
Yeah, Jace left it on top of his library. There was good reasons for that. Yeah, that is definitely a proxy for Flash.
Ashen Rider being the card he's flashing in.
Flashen Rider, are you saying?
Flashen Rider, getting it, exiling 2 permanents.
I could see some Flashen Rider tomorrow in Highlander. That could be sweet.
Yeah, bear in mind, guys, tomorrow from 11 a.m. Australian Eastern Standard Time, that is 9 p.m. New York time, late evening European time. No, it's the middle of the night European time.
Yeah, bright and early.
Bright and early. Get up. Come watch some Australian Highlander. Australian Highlander is a singleton format. We'll be streaming it. It's taken very seriously. In a joking fashion. Jocular fashion. It is jocularly taken seriously here in Melbourne, where we play all the hipster formats.
Of course.
Seriously, we got Highlander and 93-94 on one tournament. Yeah. One tournament weekend being streamed.
That's impressive.
We are all the cool kids.
Zombub, I'm not sure if your playmat would have been the best in the room. I don't know if you know of Rob Gaskard's playmat, but it was around. So here we see, what have we got? Is that a waterfront bouncer? Is Lee Greaves, in fact, playing Spellshaper Tribal?
Cavern of Souls named Spellshaper.
So the Spellshapers are all pay a cost, discard a card to
do
play
something.
The spell that matches that cost. So Waterfront Bouncer is pay a blue, discard a card to unsummon. It somehow turns every card in your hand into an unsummon.
Lee Greaves is famous for bringing whatever he wants. He is a semi-proficient stacks player.
Yeah.
He's quite good when he does play the stacks decks, but he's been branching out recently.
Yeah, look, he doesn't want to be predictable. He wants to be...
And if you're playing Ashen Rider, Defense Grid, Waterfront Bouncer, you are anything but predictable.
Yeah, look, I wouldn't know what to say. I do like the synergy here between Flash and Defense Grid. You know, you want to cast a creature on your opponent's turn with Flash, but that's going to cost you three more.
Why do you want to flash a creature on your opponent's turn and not your turn?
What's the point of flashing on your turn? Isn't Flash so that you can play things on your opponent's turn?
No, Flash is so you can exile two permanents.
That's silly. You pay a blue and one, and then you pay the difference between your creature and the
Fair
two.
Flash.
Yeah. That's how Flash works, right? It just gives your creature Flash.
We've got our word on the floor saying Lee forgot about Defense Grid.
So he passed turn with the intention of flashing. unfortunately, he's not able to merely give his creature flash because it costs too much. Is that a disenchant in Graham's hand? Disenchant the Defense Grid. Disenchant the Defense Grid.
Misdirection.
Graham, you're letting us down.
I think we do need to prove to these guys that we do actually have vintage decks here.
One of these is a vintage deck. So we see a Waterfront Bouncer activation in response to the disenchant.
Five damage. Lee goes to four.
Yeah, it doesn't look like a good situation for Lee. It does look like he's playing a completely different deck this time around, though. No mountains on his board. Did he sideboard into a different deck? Is that the plan? There is a typo in the life totals. Lee Greaves is not, in fact, on 42. He might be in with a shot if he was on 42. Oh, a flashed in Goblin Welder.
Is he going to pay the difference?
He did not pay the difference. That's a bit unfortunate. Going for the scoop, and Graham says no.
No, you may not scoop.
Classic Blue Mage, always in control of everything. These guys having entirely too much fun.
Okay, while we're waiting for this game to wrap up, we have a new deck for you here, and I'm sure you'll be going out and playing it, and you can mangle this to your heart's content.
Alright, how do I play Storm?
I hope your mind's desires don't leave as much to be desired as my mind's desires yesterday.
Is there Burning Wish? Am I learning
no
a Burning
Wish?
Wish. Sweet, this game's easy.
I managed to I was quite salty yesterday after mind's desiring for 13. I had played a land, so I needed 4 mana off non-land mana sources on 13, 26 outs out of something like 38 cards,
yeah,
and whiffed.
This is Tendrils, right, this card?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's how proficient a Storm player I am. I don't know what Tendrils looks like. Normally they just put it on the stack and I either concede or don't. Welcome back to the booth.
I'm Joshua Butler. We're here with Jim. I'm here with Jimbo Dowling. This is the Next Level Games After Dark.
And this is what's on stream next. Unfortunately, it's me, it's this deck, it's going to be bad.
And you guys are going to love it. We're here, the...
What sort of sanctioned monster puts these in the same box as a Storm deck?
The person who lent out Null Rods to someone else. I don't think that was correct. No, I managed yesterday to take that deck to a 2-3 finish.
Yeah, we'll have to let Graham know that once he's done with Lee, he's having a different opponent step in, a new challenger.
Though, to be fair, I beat Graham yesterday.
Oh, well, I've got a benchmark, I guess.
Yep, you've got to beat him in 3 games.
3? What if I do it in 2?
If you do it in 2, even better.
Yeah. Alright, that's my plan.
We're here, we're just having a pretty casual stream on the vintage event that's happening just outside. We had, as I said, 50 players here yesterday for Sanctioned Vintage. We had another 67 for Legacy today. Tomorrow's going to be Highlander. Yeah, burn 1 hour, Legacy. Yeah, I'm sorry, we hang our heads in shame.
Good news is there's no burn in the Vintage.
No burn in the Vintage. Actually, they were talking just before on what burn does. Because when you upgrade from Modern to Legacy, mm-hmm. you get Fire Blast, you get Price of Progress, you get all the cool burn spells, and then they're like, well, what do you get from Vintage? You get Mox Ruby.
Excuse me, you get the one, the only, the Standstill Breaker, Black Vice.
Black Vice, now we're talking.
Yeah, I took 6 from my Black Vice once.
Oh no.
It broke my Standstill.
I remember when I was playing Zoo, attempting to build Zoo for Legacy.
Did Graham just get him?
I think Graham just got him. Oh, he hangs his head in shame.
Scoop him up, son. That pithing needle is on the fetch. Yeah, Avid, we've got a really fast-growing Vintage community here. Yeah, Parasitic Pillar gets a lot better than and Eidolon. They get a lot better in Vintage because of... because of the boxes.
Is that Wasteland? I don't know what that card is.
Which then it,
Ingot Chewer. Is that a proxy Ingot Chewer?
That is a proxy Ingot Chewer.
Hang your head in shame.
Yeah, you get to add Null Rod, Black Vice, cards like that, and then...
Wheel of Fortune's the big one.
And then, of course, you can play Shrapnel Blast, because you've got these artifacts that you're playing for no reason, so...
Yep, I think anyone can see that the power jump between Modern and Legacy is a lot bigger than Legacy to Vintage.
Absolutely.
The power for jump Burn in particular.
The power jump between Standard and Modern is actually not that big for Burn.
Yeah, you're turning from a turn 5 deck to a turn 4 deck.
Yeah, exactly. Ataka's Command is good in both.
Is that the Cone of Flame?
No, it's the Command. So choose 2. You've got...
You're trying to tell me what a card in Standard does, right?
Yeah.
Okay, first, what does its cost?
Red-green.
Alright.
It's an instant.
That's good.
Choose 2.
Yeah.
Your opponents players cannot gain life this turn.
Mm-hmm.
Each opponent takes 3, not targeted. So here we have a strictly better Skullcrack.
Mm-hmm.
Creatures you control get 1/1 and reach until end of turn. Or the mythical Fortist, put a land from your hand into play.
For red green.
Yeah. So choose 2.
So ramp, Skullcrack.
Yep. Well, you got the 2 halves of Skullcrack.
Mm-hmm.
And pump my team.
And pump your team. Yeah, seems alright.
You know, Dragon Fodder's in Standard.
Is that the 2 cost make 2 1 ones?
Yeah, there's also a 3 cost make 3 1 ones.
I want to play that deck.
And Monastery Swift Spear?
Actually, is Blue White Heroic still in Standard? Because yeah, apparently you can build that deck for $20.
That's probably accurate. Lee is having all of the fun in the world.
It's because he's proxying an Ingot Chewer, that's why. Graham is just showing what happens to people who proxy Ingot Chewers.
Graham's got a Tolarian Academy there. It's got the mountain underneath ready for the Blood Moon. Coming prepared. Lee Greaves has not drawn his most powerful mana acceleration in these last couple of games. There's been none of the mythical, not restricted Simian Spirit Guide to be seen. You know, Graham plays his Mox, Lee plays his Spirit Guides, it's all even. Graham is having a field day with this Scalding Tarn. Is that Brainstorm I just caught a sight of?
Now, I think what Lee is, what Graham is doing here, is he's going to tick up Jace just to see what Lee's playing.
Yeah, he's going for the information. It's game three. He needs some information on what his opponent's actually playing.
What I think Lee needs to do is he needs to find, like, Italian, Japanese, German copies of all these cards, so no one knows what he's doing.
Can you even find an Italian in the Eye of Chaos?
I'd assume it would have been in Renaissance.
It was in Legends, right?
Yeah, well, Legends was replaced overseas by Renaissance.
But Italian Legends is
slightly
popular, I've heard.
Oh, Italian's Legends boosters, I remember winning those.
Yeah.
4 weeks after the event. I actually think it was more than that.
Graham, ticking up the Jace here. He's got a plan.
Sorry about that, JSAC. Yeah, the mics here are a bit sensitive, guys who are watching. If we do start breathing into the mics, we apologize. Just let us know and we'll adjust the headsets.
Lee Greaves, in a pickle, ratchet bomb. No, none of that. Spell snare.
Graham, let Lee have fun. He's
blue mage for life.
Prison mage for life. Prison or rituals. Maybe I should create the prison ritual deck.
Prison ritual?
Dark ritual smokestack.
I'm not sure how I feel about this.
What are you expecting to turn up tomorrow for the Highlander event?
I'm expecting the blue-red twin vault deck to be big.
When we are heavy breathing, we are excited about Vintage.
Yeah, but when am I not excited about Vintage?
I am a fat white cat, if I remember the picture correctly. KnowYourMeme.com. No, it's Breathes Heavily.
Yeah, this game is close to sealed up. You can almost stick a fork in it. It is done. Which means that Graham better get ready for the master. This is not 7-point Highlander. This is a Vintage League game.
Lee Greaves running only a brew only Lee Greaves could run.
Is that said in the same way as a face only a mother could love?
No, everyone loves Lee Greaves brews.
Yeah, you're right.
Lee Greaves was a huge proponent of blacks. In the first years. Was a huge proponent of blacks in the first years that I was starting to play Vintage. Blacks...
Is that a Sol Ring proxied on a Mana Crypt?
I believe it is a Sol Ring proxied on a Mana Crypt.
All class here.
And that's his Atalarian Academy again. Yeah, blacks. When I was first getting into Vintage, he was playing a couple of workshops,
mm-hmm.
Dark Rituals,
yep.
Liliana of the Veil, Bloodghast, Bazaar of Baghdad, Thorns. Yes, that's Thorn and Dark Ritual in the same deck.
The combo.
Thoughtseize, Phyrexian Totem.
Ooh, that's a good one.
And along with the Phyrexian, did I say Liliana's?
Yeah.
Yep, Thoughtseize. I remember one day being absolutely blown out. He goes, workshop, Phyrexian Totem. And I'm like, what does it do? Phyrexian Totem is a 3-cost artifact that you can pay black and one
mm-hmm.
to turn it into a Phyrexian Negator.
Mm-hmm.
Hey. So I'm like, does nothing. It also has tap for black. Taps it for black Thoughtseize. I'm like, oh.
I'll tell you what, I'm going to jump out. I'm going to grab this Vintage deck, and I'm going to give Graham a game.
Okay.
I will...
You need to give him at least 7. Let's go till you win. We'll be here all night.
All right, I'll chat to you later.
That's all right. If Lee wants to jump in, get him to jump in. We'll be back in 2 seconds. Hello everybody, I'm back now. I'm here with Lee Greaves, master of many.
Many a failed attempt at playing vintage, that's for sure. Hope you enjoyed that, everybody.
Many a failed attempt at wearing a microphone. That's alright, you just use that one, Lee. It goes around the back. Look. Yep, that's right. Okay, now wear it like a pair of sunglasses backwards.
Sweet.
Wear it like you're cool and living in Sydney.
Welcome to Noobsville.
Yes. Hello, everyone. This is myself, Joshua Butler. I'm here with Lee Greaves. We just watched Lee be annihilated by the greatest card in Vintage, Pithing Needle.
I would like to. I'd like to just say to everybody out there that this is a guy who's come second in two major tournaments this weekend. So. I'm definitely not that person myself.
Nor am I. It's the guy out there who we just saw play Pithing Needle. What do you think about Pithing Needle and its place in Vintage?
To be honest, I actually really like it. If you compare it with Revoker, I think being able to name lands is very important. I play it over Revoker because I like to name Wasteland.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And when it comes down against you with a Scalding Tarn in play?
I'd like to hear all about it later on.
That sounds good.
I'm humble enough to know when I make my mistakes.
We're going to be cutting soon to Jimbo, who's going to be running my Storm list from yesterday. I'm pretty sure it's still 60 cards. And my sideboard's over here, so he's going to have fun against 15 counterspell deck. It's going to be a great game. We're going to jump down to him now.
So which brand of Storm is this that we're going to see?
This is going to be TPS. Yes. Very similar to the 2008 Paul Mastriano won Vintage Worlds 2008 with Pitchlong.
Yep.
It's very similar to that. So we are running the four basics in the main deck, two Swamps, two Islands. We are going to be running with four Dark Rituals, two Cabal Rituals, the usual Storm complement or the old Storm complement of Seal, DT, VT, Will, Scroll, Grim Tutor. I think that's it for the tutors.
Am I right? This is not a Burning Wish
No
style?
Burning Wish in this. No. This is straight blue-black.
Yep.
It gives you both upsides and downsides, particularly against workshops. It means you get to run more, the four basics main deck, and if you want additional basics in the sideboard, and which really help against just outlasting the spheres. You'll generally be able to make your land drops, use your lands to play Moxen, whereas a lot of other Storm decks just caught on their one basic, maybe get the second non-basic into play and watch it just get wasted and just stay on a low mana count. Obviously against workshops, this deck just wants to Hercules end of turn and go off.
Now here you would think that Graham's got a very good game against this Storm deck, wouldn't you?
Oh, yes. Graham's got a... I did manage to beat him round one of the Vintage yesterday. I don't think he was too happy.
It didn't really matter too much. He still became a finalist.
Yeah, he still came to say I was his only loss in the Swiss. And I proceeded to go, like, I won my next round and loss. Okay, I'll drop now.
Okay, so drawn. They've decided to keep...
Island go, powerful start for the Storm deck. I really want a little guy just sitting inside Jimbo's brain with a little walkie-talkie telling me what he's thinking. Jimbo here, not a proficient Storm pilot. He's openly said he dislikes playing Storm. He doesn't like he prefers to play the long control-y games with Jace and...
Yeah, I think I can understand that. All the calculations, keeping track of storm count, keeping track of mana color and quantity. Life total very relevant. There are just too many aspects for the brain to have to compute with. I can't even respond to a pithing needle appropriately. So, storm's definitely not for me either.
Graham with the main deck, Grafdigger's Cage, just casually popping it out there. Keeps the one lander by the looks of it.
I really like the Grafdigger's Cage in the main deck. It surprises a lot of people. It surprised the Dredge player in CanCon when he won the CanCon Vintage event.
I believe he played it in... Was it CanCon that he played against... what's his name was on Dredge? Isaac Egan was on Dredge. No, I think it was Masters last year. Isaac Egan was on Dredge. And he just plays turn one caged, and Isaac was just like, okay, I guess I'm not in the winning end for this one.
Well, that was the same too with CanCon, I believe. In the finals, it was first turn Graf Digger's cage against Shroom Dredge.
Oh, Shroom Dredge.
yes, to a very displeased opponent.
Shroom Dredge, a very Australian thing. I don't think I've ever seen any lists outside Buster playing it here.
Yeah, I played it once when I tried to see whether I liked Dredge a few years ago.
Do you like Dredge?
No, that's why I didn't continue. I think I'm a bit like Jimbo, where I'd like to try and just control a match on my terms. I like to.
That's why you should play Shops again.
I know, I should. So yeah, Shroom is also... Shroom has also been seen in some other strange deck lists in its time too, like Cerebral Assassin.
Cerebral Assassin. That I remember when Andy Horn used to play Cerebral all the time.
What's happening here?
Okay, so Duress has come down. He's seen two Trinket Mages, Oriok Salvages.
Yeah,
that's nothing. And was that a drain? And
there was a drain there. Yes.
Okay, so it looks like there's no interaction here coming from Graham.
No. He's been bricked on one land.
Yeah. Can we get it moved down just a little bit? Yeah, so we can read the red writing. Let's see, how many life total?
All the life, just about.
I hope he's not paying 13 life right now.
I think he's just paid 13 life right now. Go hard or go home, says Jimbo.
Oh, God. This will be excellent. Well, he does know his opponent has nothing.
Fairly deep.
He is exiling the cards.
So he's keeping all this for next turn. He doesn't think Graham can do 5 damage by next turn.
Doesn't need lands. Imperial Seal not needed.
Yeah.
Graham probably sitting there going, hey, that's my Imperial Seal.
What's he got? Looks like there's a couple of Moxes he's picked up from there. Doesn't even want an extra draw 7. He's confident.
Well, he doesn't want to give his opponent 7 cards. If he's got 15 counter spells in his main deck, he's lucky that he hasn't drawn as many thus far.
It could help him with his own storm count.
Yeah, what did the force... What was forced? Was it the Brainstorm?
What's been exiled for force, or has he had to pitch it?
Oh, he might have just pitched it to discard.
Yeah. What are we at? Jimbo's turn 3. Who was on the play again?
Jimbo was. He went Island Go to Island Aether Spellbomb from Graham.
So Graham's yet to have his third turn?
I believe so.
Okay, so he would have only... He shouldn't have discarded then, should he?
Possibly. I love Necro. Necro is just my card. Getting rid of the Talarian's big game. I think that was a Flooded Strand. Oh, he's got Drain up.
So what do you think the reasoning is behind getting behind exiling 2 Moxes? They can be very
just
helpful
cards
for Storm.
In hand. Simply cards in hand. No, Matt, this is not Legacy. This is Vintage. The Legacy event finished earlier this evening. We had 67, and unfortunately, depending on where you look at it, Burn won. So at the end of the day, Burn took out 67 other players to become first place in Legacy. It looks like we haven't changed the Twitch channel stuff at the moment, so we're going to have a look at that and get that changed, hopefully. The name. So, but this is Vintage League, so the Vintage League is just a more casual Vintage event that we're playing here. We've got the stream here. We've got Vintage decks. Let's play some Vintage.
And we've got the ability to give it to you here, live. So we may as well make the most of it while it's all been set up.
Well, I don't think he's casting Dig Through Time. Come on, Jimbo, you can do it. I think, is that a Grim Tutor or a Demonic Tutor in his hand? I think it's a
Grim. Yep,
that's a Grim Tutor.
That's,
No, I can't do it.
So you think a bit too deep on the necro?
Oh, think, yes, definitely. Way too deep on that necro.
Do you
necro
think you maybe should have planned for a turn or two later?
Yeah, like, with your opponent not having much, like, only a drain, even if he does get the land, I would have necroed for...
Maybe just top your hand back up to 7?
Usually in this deck, I'd like to go a little bit overboard, go to 8 or even 9 cards because of the high density of mana sources, particularly lands for a storm deck. I only need to keep one land, so the rest can all
go. That way you can sort of filter out a few unwanted bits and pieces.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, generally you want to make sure the coast is clear. I would have probably gone, as I said, 4 or 5 cards, try and find another duress, get that drain out of his hand, and then gone for the full slog. But I don't think Jimbo simply didn't count how much mana he needed for what he needed. He used his Gitaxian Probe to put him to 3, and then he couldn't cast Grim Tutor because he was dead.
Yes.
See, that was, to me, from the board state where he landed Necro, should have been a shoo-in. His opponent had one counterspell, didn't have enough mana to even cast that counterspell.
And there was no force backing up anywhere. It's safe to say that Graham's not running... it's fairly safe to say that Graham's not running a Mindbreak Trap or something that Storm really hates like that.
I think he does in the board.
Okay.
I did definitely play against Mindbreak Trap.
Okay.
Bear in mind, he does have Misdirection. So an Xaxxy Storm count might not get you there.
Yes.
Misdirect your last copy of your tendrils.
That'll actually leave him on 4 life too.
Few things will make you fume as hard as that.
I still really like this stifle against the storm trigger. I think that's.
Yep.
I've seen a few storm players ask whether that's actually able to happen.
Yes, it is. It can definitely happen, and it really ruins your day if you haven't been able to duress that. Did we see what he got with the Grim Tutor?
No, I believe it's a proxy card.
That last proxy is a Cabal Ritual. I borrowed a Cabal Ritual. He has both the Tinker and the Memory Jar. This deck does not play a robot in the main deck. Much like the 2014, what's his name? Reed Duke played in the Vintage event, the 2014 Vintage Champs. He also had a Blightsteel Colossus only in the sideboard. He hasn't missed that he can simply tinker away that Mox into a Black Lotus, which is
effectively just casting.
Effectively just adding a Black Lotus to his board for next turn.
Once again, Memory Jar is a dangerous card against a control player.
Memory Jar, best use of Memory Jar, besides just winning on the spot, is Herkulesing your workshop playing opponent inside it. You cast the Herkules, you ask them if sadness resolves, and they simply say yes.
And Graham's protecting something there.
Even in the misstep metagame, Duress is still pretty good at just getting rid of counters out of hands.
Yes, for sure.
Yes, the Force of Will will still be in there, and that's annoying. But just emptying their hand of cards is still very, very relevant.
Two mental missteps there. Can't be too many more left for this game.
Yeah, the other kind of more grim long style Storm decks, quite often all they want to do is just go, here's a bomb, can you counter it? Here's a bomb, can you counter it? Here's a bomb, can you counter it? Whereas with the Perfect Storm, which is what this list is, you kind of want to develop your mana, develop some cards in hand, then eventually you want to duress them, go off, because you know there's nothing they can do. Draw a card, says Graham. Do you have any predictions for the Highlander tomorrow?
In all honesty, I don't know Highlander metagame at all. But from what I hear and what I read, I think Zoo is usually one of the biggest things.
No, Carlyre is one of the biggest things.
Okay.
Don't know if Zoo is.
True. And from what I gather also, like, Siege Rhino's done a lot to warp the format towards Abzan colours as well.
Yeah, a lot more mid-range decks are definitely out there.
Yeah.
Force of Will, often surprising players who are not expecting it from the storm opponent. And then I believe that's a misdirection. No, you force my misdirection.
Jimbo looks like he's got two cards in his hand.
One mana source allows him to cast the Memory Jar, which is all right.
Yeah.
I expect Zoo to do well tomorrow. I also expect... I kind of want the Tinker decks to come back. The Tinker decks have gone out of the format a little bit, particularly the Tinker Time Vault decks.
Yep.
More in favor of the Magus of the Moon style Time Vault decks that just want to play a moon and then will eventually take all the turns with Time Vault.
Yep.
Those decks are very powerful, but once again, my favorite in all of Highlander are the combo decks. I'm going to be in the booth all tomorrow, hopefully if I get enough sleep. I'm going to be showing you all the combo decks of Highlander.
Do you So for people overseas who might not know, have we got people overseas listening?
Yeah, we had a few earlier. We had earlier in the day, we had some Norwegians, we had some Americans.
So those who aren't familiar, Australian 7-point Highlander is a format which was developed here sort of by negotiation between Canberra and Melbourne, where certain powered cards are pointed, just depending on their power level. You know, we have a committee here that decides what cards are more powerful than others. For example, Ancestral Recall is 4 points, I believe.
Is Black Lotus.
As is Black Lotus and Tinker.
And Yawgmoth's World, they're the only 4-pointers?
I thought Yawgmoth was 3.
Is it 3? You can play 3. Lotus Will.
Yeah. So... you get 7 points in which to spend. There is a list detailing cards between 1 through to 4 points. And, yeah, you go ahead and build a singleton format 60-card deck just with those points in mind. So Josh is the avid combo player.
Mm-hmm.
He likes to play a Lich's Mirror combo. Would you like to describe what that's all about?
So Lich's Mirror is a Conflux Rare... which says, if you would die, you shuffle all your permanents, your graveyard, and your hand into your library. You draw 7. You go back up to 20 life, and you draw 7 cards. channel is obviously the Alpha Beta Unlimited 2 green card that says, until the end of your turn, you may pay one life to add one colorless to your mana pool, and you may do this at any time. Or, sorry, you can do it at instant speed, whatever the errata is. So basically, what your plan is you want to cast Channel. And let's just look at this triple Force of Will jar hand.
Jimbo can't believe what's going on here.
Force. I am very impressed. So, Jimbo, what's it like to be variants out of Magic? Storm's 10.
There's one black mana, I just need three more.
Could have Duressed. So the whole point is you cast Channel, which you use to pay five life, and you put Lich's Mirror into play. You then pay 15 life, say you're on 20 to begin with, and you kill yourself. So you keep to 20, you use whatever spells you have in your new hand to find Lich's Mirror again. You're obviously running Mox Opal, Chrome Mox, Mox Diamond, various baubles that you can turn colorless mana into colored mana, because it's not all at once. Channel says until the end of your turn. So you can keep paying mana to cast spells, to shift it into colored mana, to cast colored spells, to find the Lich's Mirror again.
And most of these are baubles cantrip, so you're constantly drawing into new resource to dig you deeper into your next
Lich's Mirror. And finding the finding the mirror, killing yourself, finding the mirror, killing yourself, finding the mirror, killing yourself. Getting mana. Composite Golem, all-star in that deck.
Is an absolute all-star in that deck. How much is he to
He's cast? A 6-cost 4-4, six colorless 4-4 that you can sacrifice to make Wooburg. And so eventually you get enough to cast Emrakul, and then you kill yourself with Lich's Mirror and do it again, find Emrakul till you've got 4 or 5 turns, extra turns stacked up, and then you say, okay, I'll go to my next turn. And you just swing for Emrakul 4 or 5 times. Generally, it only takes 2.
Yeah. Unless your opponent has that ensnaring bridge you've been dreading.
Oh, you've got a bounce spell, a singular bounce spell in their deck. You'll find the bounce spell. Jimbo here not looking like he is having fun.
He's definitely not looking like a Storm player.
The other deck you can definitely be running is, if you're looking into combo in a singleton format, World Gorge of Dragons, a lot of fun. You use Bazaar of Baghdad to put the dragon in your graveyard. You reanimate it with either Necromancy, Dance of the Dead, or Animate Dead. Gives you infinite draw and discard, which allows you to put an Una or something like a Woo Spy into your graveyard, and then you start looping it with Eternal Witness, and it just gets crazy from there. Woo Spy, blue and 1/1. Look at the top two cards of a library when it comes into play. Put one onto the bottom of that player's library. No, one on top of that player's library, and one is the graveyard, and so you can mill your opponent out just by looping that, and then casting an instant to make them draw a card. Or you can Una to exile their entire library. Yeah, it's a lot of fun. Combo in singleton format is very difficult, though. That's why the more consistent decks like Sewer, better.
So, how many hits has Jimbo taken now? He's now down to 7. And Graham just showing us that he's covered with a drain. And I believe he has Salvages. Mm. Oh, no, Resto. He's not playing Salvages in this list, I don't believe.
No, he will have a Singleton Salvages there. Okay. Force of Will off the Dark Ritual.
Oh, very good, Jimbo.
No, Mitchell, this is Vintage. This is what we had yesterday. Tomorrow will be Highlander. We'll see if we can get some Highlander lists after this game is finished. On the stream for you. We'll see if anyone else is still in the store, because I think it's just us now. This is not fair. He can play zero-cost artifacts, but Jimbo doesn't.
There's that salvage we were just talking about.
The Lotus is in the bin. Infi mana. Sadness resolves.
Scoop phase. I wonder how much punishment Jimbo can go through.
Can he take another?
It looks like he is.
He's going for another. And this, Graham just keeps... we're going to see Storm just turn one of them. The TPS, which is this deck here on the left that Jimbo's playing, the Storm variant, has a very low, like, turn one, turn two percentage of actually being able to go. If it doesn't run the a lot of acceleration that the much more explosive Storm decks do, it doesn't have the Mox Opals, it doesn't have Gush, so it's a much slower, more methodical style of Storm deck. Very close to, or very akin to, I'd say, well, probably the 5-seed Doomsday decks in Legacy, that no one plays them anymore. To be fair, no one plays this TPS anymore.
So what can we discuss about Graham's deck and his choice of cards and playstyle?
Graham's done very well for himself over the past 6 months. He came second at this event. He came first at the Vintage event at CanCon in January. It was only 17 or so players, but he did come top of that event, basically with the same list. I think he only changed two or three cards.
And I think Monastery Mentor came into this deck within a week or so of it being released, maybe a couple of weeks.
He does play a Monastery Mentor because when he's comboing off, the traditional Bomberman lists would simply play around 20 powers, creatures, get them all into play, and cast Time Walk. With the Monastery Mentor, it just becomes so much easier for that to happen.
Yes, Jimbo definitely had to get rid of that first turn salvages.
You didn't have white mana. Scroll. Time Walk.
Possibly Explore.
Jimbo playing Explore. All the blue mana. Just come on, someone play a Null Rod. Top, not a card you want to see your opponent having active when you're a Storm Pilot. You just want to... You'd rather them not have a hand of 10 cards, particularly three of them you're not allowed to duress.
It's, Brainstorm is bad enough, and luckily there's only one in this format. But to have that ability to choose which card are the top three...
Oh, no, you're allowed 5 Brainstorms in this format. 4 Jace and 1 Brainstorm.
True. You can't end of turn Jace, though. Or in response Jace.
That's what we need, guys. Everyone, petition Wizards. Jace's ability should be allowed to be instants.
Come on, he's broken enough as he is.
Jace is a terrible card, and you should feel terrible for playing him.
I have 2 cards on principle I don't play. Jace the Mind Sculptor is one, and Tarmogoyf is the other. And there's probably a good reason why I don't put up good results, too. But both cards are cards I despise greatly. But at least Jace is a good card.
Yeah. Tarmogoyf, actually not as invalidated as a lot of people expected when Young Pyromancer came into the field. We had 0 Young Pyromancers in the top 8 of our Legacy event today, but we did have 12 Tarmogoyfs. We had 3 Rug Delver players make top 8. Unfortunately, 2 of them lost in the top 8. The last one made it all the way to the finals before losing to Burn.
Burn is a great deck. I love the fact that Burn was able to make it today.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of people feel very, very much like it's an expensive format, which it is, but it stops them from being able to get into the format. And I like that there are decks like Burn around creating some success and being able to show people that you don't have to have every single expensive card to actually be able to play in this format.
I know you're not a very proficient Storm pilot. That's not a hand you want your opponent to have when you duress them.
I can tell that from here. Multiple Force of Wills, and is that two drains?
Two mana drains.
Yes, and plenty of pitch outlets.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
I would love to see Jimbo's face right now.
And a little man with a microphone inside his head.
Yeah. Bear in mind. Oh, it doesn't really matter, but he only had to fight through two counter spells if he wanted to go off right then. He can't drain and force and drain again.
He's got to be able to keep his gas up, though, I think. Academy has only given him one extra mana.
Mm-hmm.
So he's only just hit 5 mana now.
What are all these sorceries and what are all these instants on the battlefield? We need a judge ruling. Can a sorcery enter the battlefield? Only if it is, what's the new ability that you put a card on?
Manifest.
Manifest. My manifest force of will.
How horrible would that mechanic have been if you flipped it over, got the effect, and it went?
Pay 3, morph your manifest into your spell again. I manifest my omniscience, unmorph it.
Granted, you are still going to have to pay, 9 mana to unmorph?
No, it's just unmorph, pay 3.
Pay 3. You have to pay its casting cost to unmorph it if it's a creature.
Oh,
no, it's wrong, but...
That's all right. Now, we did put the challenge to Jimbo that he would be sitting there playing until he won a game.
Oh, okay. I thought I was going home tonight.
That's not very nice.
Well, I have seen him on 2 cards very often in these games.
Mm-hmm. We have seen him lose to the triple force. Well, if he manages to get a memory jar down, his opponent won't have triple force of will this time. Blue 4, Sol Ring. And that's a mental misstep. Lotus. Lotus is quite dangerous here because Lotus gives him access to Mind's Desire. So if that's a Duress, Demonic Tutor, Sol Ring, Lotus, Mind's Desire, that's a Mind's Desire 4, 5, 6. I think we're going to see a Desire here.
And I think he might be protected with the Force of Will too.
I suppose it's not mostly irrelevant. He can still counter 2 copies, I see. Yep. Mind's Desire. Now that should be including the spell Pierce 6, I think. We've got... play the Duress, play the DT, play the Sol Ring, play the
Lotus,
play the Spell Pierce. Yep, for 6.
They look like they've only got 5 there. There's... Yep. So Josh just letting the guys know that there might be a miscount in the storm count, and correcting the amount of storm. So 5 storm. That's pretty good call for Jimbo. And the last thing he needs is to get most of them to be land for him.
So how many were counted while I was running?
I'm not sure what's happening at the moment, because he's got 3 there now.
Well, the copies can be forced and drained.
Oh, okay, so he's... That's right. So Graham's spent up on counter spells to get rid of copies.
That is a bad draw.
Very bad.
Bad
Another
draw.
Bad one. and that was a fizzle.
Mm-hmm. It left much to be desired, you might say.
So that little man with a microphone inside Jimbo's head is desiring more.
He is desiring more.
To his credit, though, he does get to play... Oh, no, because he did play an Academy this turn, didn't he? No, that's been out
for... No, the Academy came out for the second land drop before the Time Walk. Oh, that's a Yawgmoth's Will.
Ooh, no, is that Tendrils?
Yay!
Tendrils gets there.
So Jimbo didn't have to wait here till after midnight our time. He's done very well and he's piloted himself to a victory with the Storm deck.
Well done. We're going to take a quick break. We're probably just going to keep looking at the table, but we'll see if we've got another game up for someone.
See you later.
Welcome back, all 22 of our viewers. We do actually have some more vintage games for you, just because we can, and we've got half an hour before we get kicked out of here for taking too long. We have a vintage gauntlet provided by one of the players, and I think the two guys, Lee and Graham, who we were looking at earlier, are just going to run through the decks for us. I'm going to be sitting down in here. I may be on my own, I may be joined, but it's going to be a lot of fun. Ask any questions. I'm just going to sit in here, goldfishing the Storm deck that you saw, and looking at what I see. And because it's vintage, I like what I see. Unfortunately, there were not enough people left in the store to be able to give you a preview for the Highlander event tomorrow, which is starting in 14 hours. Hopefully I'll be able to get some sleep tonight. But it looks like we've got a shop deck on the right. This is entirely proxied, paid for by Officeworks. Thank you. Now, I'm not sure what we have on our left here. No doubt it shall become evident. Thorn of Amethyst, one if not two shops on the right. Oh, Monastery Mentor. So Mentor versus a shops variant. We'll check out whether it's Gush or Mentor. We'll see what happens. Thorn of Amethyst, that's going to hurt. Ooh, is he thinking of Force of Willing the Thorn? Force Pitching Dig, interesting. Unless he's going for the turn one Mentor, I don't necessarily agree with that. I'm going to be sitting here backseat drive. Only 17 viewers. 9 of you don't like me. Brainstorm Tangle Wire. Under Tangle Wire. Oh, that's a misdirection. That's not something he wants. Yes, Collington. 10 people, but we got a couple more. We still don't know exactly what kind of mentor list is being played on the by Lee Greaves on the left-hand side, nor truly what kind of shops deck is being played by Graham on the right. So Chalice for zero? Yep, Chalice for zero. Looks like Lee brainstorm locked himself. Tap it down. All the lands so far down. So who is tuning in? Where do I know you? Where are we from? Do we like vintage? I suppose I do have to thank the guys at Sneak and Show putting on a stream, letting us just basically run it over time. The actual guys have left, we know how to turn it off. We'll run it off as soon as we get kicked out of the store, but this is actually an amazing opportunity to show off a bit of vintage. We did have 50 players for the vintage event yesterday, for sanctioned vintage. That was amazing. Won by Espresso Stacks. Again, Graham just not giving off what he's playing. Ye old average sphere. Because this is a lot later in a much more casual atmosphere, The usual guys doing the life totals and things like that, they're not doing that at the moment, so I'm just doing it here on paper as much as I can follow along. Elects to put a chalice on zero through the sphere.
Hey man, you got an Imperial seal that Graham can steal from you?
Really, the only shops deck I can narrow out here, Marinara, which is very old, no one plays it anymore, and the Mana Crypt precludes. And Terra Nova. Other than that, he could be playing Martello, could be playing Espresso, we just haven't seen any titular cards. And to be fair, the only reason I know the Lee's on the Mentor deck is I saw a Mentor. Is he cashing in a Lotus for a Mox? Are you playing Elvish Visionary in modern in your modern queue, Zumbub? All the cards from Lee. Thank you. Siberian, this is just end of the day. We've had a 50-player sanctioned event, sanctioned vintage yesterday, followed by a 67-player sanctioned legacy event. These are a couple of guys just sitting at the end of the store. We still had the stream going, so these guys are currently running full proxied. Earlier we saw some decks that had all the cards, but this is just a vintage gauntlet that our store has. So these guys are just picked up and they're jamming games. So what you're seeing is 100% proxy, except for that Italian mana drain, that's real. Normally in tournaments here in Melbourne, it fluctuates between 10 and 15. For the number of proxies you're allowed to play in a vintage event. For the larger events, the GPs as well as Masters, they are all sanctioned only. And as I said, we did manage to get 50 players for our sanctioned vintage yesterday. It was amazing. We on the play again. Monastery Mentor seems good on the play. What is everyone's thoughts about Monastery Mentor, particularly in Vintage? I don't get it. I know, I can see it's very powerful. I can see it closes games out. But I just think the extra mana between the 2 on Young Pyromancer and the 3 on Monastery Mentor is just... I don't think it's worth it. Being able to have that low land count, such good celerity you get with actually playing spells that unfortunately in your mentor decks are just taken up by the Moxen needed to cast it. I just think you get more out of Mentor and more out of Pyromancer and the Pyromancer style decks than you do out of Mentor. It's possible that the Mentor deck has not yet been fully explored. Graham's Wasteland, they're playing right into Lee's tempo strategy. Tangawire? Come on, be a Tangawire. Yeah. I don't have the deck list or anything here, but it really seems that Lee's low land count has bit him in every one of these games. Fun Sphere! The best card in Magic to say, let's have some fun. If they found a way to make the Trinisphere shells in Legacy more consistent, I really feel that they would be quite powerful. They're already powerful, they just don't have the consistency to get those Chalice Trinisphere hands. Maybe they should get the workshop. We haven't seen any metal workers, so the Staff of Nen's a bit odd coming out of the shop's deck, but... Lee having fun. I believe that's the official term here. For those who have just tuned in, you're watching Next Level Games After Dark. The store is basically closed. We've just got a couple of guys jamming some vintage games with me sitting in the booth. I'm Joshua Butler. You can find me at Vintage Familiar. And Lee's scooping them up for the third time. That's not enough of a sideboard. Three chewers. Is that a Hercules underneath? No. Respect your shops, players. And did you not bring in your wear tear? Lee. I don't know if they've given up for the night or simply gone to get new lists. Graham seems to still be sitting there. I feel bad because I've eaten a whole packet of Pascal wine gums while this is going on, but wine gums are so good. Also, Lee's changed decks. Come on, Lee. Dredge, Lee. Lee's changing again. A quick reminder for everyone who's still there, we do have a Highlander event, Australian Highlander event tomorrow. That's going to be... Oh, we got Merfolk on the left. Here we go. Now, Australian Highlander is a singleton format with a points list. Lee feeling really bad there. Force your mocks, lose to a tangle wire. Playing multiple lands, are we, Lee? What?
How many lands did you play, Lee?
Did he just cheat? Did he cheat on camera? Awesome!
Cheating on camera!
Okay, so what happened just there is Lee forgot to play a land on turn 2, and they told him to just put it into play. That's why he managed to play two lands on turn 3. He cast Explore in his mono blue deck. Where'd you get the shop list?
It was the vintage, super vintage leagues.
Okay, it's one of the vintage league, the VSL lists, our shop list there. Just trying to work out which one.
Martello shops.
It is Martello? Cool. Yeah. Just haven't seen any Forge Masters or anything like that.
Really?
No.
Yeah, it is Martello shops.
The owner and creator of the... vintage box came in and just told me that it was Forge Masters indeed. I phantasmal image for value. Looks like both players are just going for the lifelink, swinging past each other. Lee, you also need to untap your land. Oh no, there was a tangle wire. Silly me. Tomorrow in the Highlander, I reckon we're going to have two zoo, a bant. I want two UR vault decks. I think Tinker's just going to be under the bracket. Reanimator. A storm list, if Neiman or Unwin or something like that turns up. That's six of the top eight. What else is going to make top eight of the Highlander? Choosing to trade off dudes here. Okay, I think some food was just offered. Back to the game presently as soon as these guys get some food. It's about 9:30 here. Most of these guys have been here since 10 o'clock, at least 10 o'clock. The vintage event this morning, sorry, legacy event this morning started at 10. So these guys have been here nearly 12 hours at least. So what are you guys' thoughts on Vintage? Are you Vintage players? Are you just tuning in because this channel's going? I do know one time we were streaming, we had, I know we had Peach from TMD or Twitter. We had him a couple of nights ago. We had, when we were streaming the top eight of the Melbourne, sorry, top four of the Melbourne Vintage League, we had Nat Mose, I'm pretty sure, come in once. We've had Wiley. All these names I recognize from TMD. Actually, I should probably put this on Twitter. There you go, out to the masses. We actually had a 93-94 tournament, or a variant thereof. Fallen Empires was legal, which someone in the chat was pointing out was not an official part of 93-94. Last night we had 10 players. It may have been the lifelink. Looks like he's going to scoop him up anyway. Lee not having a lot of fun here. I think that's 0-4 for Lee. Knowing Lee, he's having plenty of fun. He's just not winning. Looks like these guys might be packing up. Possibly the case, Toku. It looks like they're maybe packing up. I'll go double check. Dear viewers, it does look like we are being kicked out of the store. So, thank you very much all for tuning in. For those of you who are still with us, you have been watching the Next Level Games Eternal Weekend. Yesterday we had Vintage, today we had Legacy, and tomorrow we have Highlander, Australia's very own singleton format. It's going to be absolutely great if you guys could tune in tomorrow. It's going to be tuning in roughly from the same time, 11 o'clock Australian Eastern Standard Time. That's 9 p.m. New York time. I believe that's American Eastern Standard. And I believe it's... I don't know, 3-4 o'clock in the afternoon in the Britain, I think, for Europe. But if you guys could tune in, that would be absolutely amazing. It's very, very cool format. It's the only format in which Zoo still has what it takes to take on a Tinker deck and come on top. When the Tinker decks are facing against Storm, which you get losing to Channel Lich's Mirror combo. It's absolutely great, but I am going to end the stream there. Thank you once again to Next Level Games and Sneak and Show for hosting the stream. That's all. See you later, guys.
Shutting that off.